Welcome to the Aaron Metaxas Show. There's a time for kidding around and a time to be serious. This is not one of them.
Broadcasting coast to coast, whatever that means.
From the Empire State Building in the heart of New York City.
This is the Aaron Metaxas Show
with your host, Aaron Metaxas.
Well, hello there. I have to tell you, folks, we've done it again. We have in the studio with me this minute, just a couple of feet away, someone who is intimately familiar with all that crazy stuff that some of you don't believe in and all that wonderful stuff that every honest human being is longing for. What am I talking about? I'm talking about something that we like to call the power of the living God. I just think so many people say, well, I'm a Christian, but they have no clue that God really wants to touch them or to be alive in their lives, to have a relationship with them or any of that stuff. And if you don't believe any of that stuff, this is the show for you, folks, because I have in studio with me somebody I like to call Judith MacNutt. Hello, Judith.
Hello, Eric.
I like to call you Judith MacNutt because that's your name.
Yes.
But I met you in St. Paul's Darien, approximately 1989, I think.
I think so.
You were there with your husband, Francis, doing a conference on healing.
That's right.
And I was so excited to hear about this because I had heard about this. But typically, when it comes to healing in the Christian church, a lot of people have this view of, you know, it's the loony fringe, basically.
Yes.
And maybe they watched Oral Roberts on TV in 1956 and it rubbed them the wrong way. It just wasn't their style or something. But you and your husband, Francis... Francis, of course, went to Harvard. There's this way you have of expressing things that it's very clearly biblical and it's very rational and there's just no weirdness. And so when you have people you can trust talking about these things, it changes it. And I remember way back then, you realize that's 28 years ago.
I do.
At least 27 years ago. That makes no sense. We were just kids back then in junior high.
Yes.
Anyway, the thing is that I remember thinking, this is real. I didn't really believe God was real. I came to know God was real in the summer of 88. I've written about that. But then to know that this other stuff was possible and that people could really get healed. Doesn't mean everybody's going to get healed, but that it's not wrong to hope and pray and believe. And you and Francis were not only instrumental in bringing that into my life, but into the lives of so many. Francis, who's obviously not here right now, but he was the pioneer in many ways.
Yes.
So if you don't mind, let's start by telling that story of how he came to be interested in this and how you two got together, you know, the sort of the background of how it all happened.
Well, Francis was a Roman Catholic priest, and I was working in Jerusalem. And he came there. And
now, wait. What were you doing in Jerusalem?
I ran a house of prayer and reconciliation.
So you were serious about your faith?
I was very serious about my faith. I had been working as a psychologist in Boston, and I made the mistake of asking God, where do you want me?
Right.
And he said, Jerusalem.
So you are a psychologist. Let me be clear. You are a psychologist. He was an ordained Roman Catholic priest.
Yes.
It's not often that a psychologist meets a Roman Catholic priest and they end up getting married. So, need to hear the rest of the story.
Yes. Well, we met. He came there to speak at a large conference on the Holy Spirit.
Mm. So this is in the 70s?
75. Yes. I'd left Boston. I went there with a friend who's also a psychologist. And we opened this house of prayer. And he came to lecture in Jerusalem. And he had written the very popular book, Healing,
right,
published by Ave Maria Press just 2 years before.
Okay, Ave Maria Press. So obviously at that point, he is preaching in his capacity as a Roman Catholic priest. And this was at the time of the charismatic renewal in the Roman Catholic Church.
Yes, yes.
Which, of course, spilled over into the Episcopal Church, the Anglican Church, via Terry Fulham, who just left us a year and a half ago. So you went out of curiosity, I suppose, to hear this great man speak.
Well, I was already very involved in healing. I'd started praying for my patients in the hospital in Boston, not with them, but for them, and I'd seen people healed. And so when I found out he was coming to Jerusalem, I immediately went to every lecture he gave and was incredibly impressed with him as a person, but also his intellect and his background. He studied in seminary for 8 years, you know, in Latin. And he just was this incredible mind, but this incredible spirit. And so our entire community in Jerusalem, the Christian community, started praying for healing after he left.
Now, to be clear, so you're in Jerusalem at the House of Prayer, which you started.
Yes.
And you minister to both Jews and Arabs.
Yes.
As well as Christians, of course.
Yes.
And that's something that I think is interesting to begin with, in the, that in the 70s that you were doing, that you had kind of a vision for reaching out to everybody.
Well, what I found when I got there, Eric, was so many of the missionaries or Christian workers were called either to the Jew or to the Arab. And on the way there, the Lord kept saying, I want you to bring reconciliation between the Jews and the Arabs through Jesus. You know, he is the Prince of Peace. He is the one that brings peace. And so we went with this idea. That's why we said it was a house of prayer and reconciliation. And it was wonderful because it was in the old Mendelbaum gate area. And that was kind of not a Jewish area and not an Arab area. So they could both come. Mm. So when we started learning about healing, we started praying not just for physical healing, but for spiritual healing, for reconciliation, for emotional healing. And we saw so many miracles. And then I saw Francis again 5 years later.
Well, I have to say that the biggest thing that keeps coming up for me is that when you see answers to prayer, when you see miracles, when you see anything like this, it bolsters your faith dramatically. I think Yes. So many people, and to some extent I'm one of them, right? You pray. Yesterday my daughter was sick. I prayed for her. And I'm sort of used to nothing happening. It doesn't mean I don't have the faith. I have the faith every time I pray. But I think that when you're around it and you see healing and you see this and that, I always say it's just like fishing. You know, when I was a kid, I go fishing. And if you're fishing for quite a while and you get nothing, you feel like you're casting your line into a swimming pool.
Yes.
Like you realize there's just nothing there. This is just a waste of time. Mm-hmm. But if you get one hit, much less a fish, it changes everything.
Yes.
So when did you feel that this was all possible, or that, I mean, were you raised as a kid in a Christian home that believed in this kind of thing?
Well, it was interesting.
Kentucky. So
yes,
you grew up in Kentucky?
Eastern Kentucky. The home I grew up in was spiritually divided like so many. You know, my mother was a strong Christian and believed in healing, and my father was not. And so I experienced three dramatic healings as a child.
Wow.
And then as an adult, I've experienced several. So it was easy for me to flow into that because of my background.
It's interesting, too, because I hear oftentimes people who have been healed, God uses them to heal others. I was mentioning the other day my friend Paul Teske, who is, you know, Paul, I was there when he was stricken, and I wrote his story in my miracles book. You know, not only was he dramatically healed, but now he goes around the world praying for people's healing. And I've got a story of him praying for somebody who's dramatically healed, and it just goes on and on and on. So I love the fact that we don't know. They're not easy rules about, you know, we do the best we can, and we kind of see what God reveals to us. But so your experience already in Jerusalem was you saw answers to healing prayer.
Absolutely. We saw Jews healed, Arabs healed. Just Christians, non-Christians, everyone that we prayed for. Not that everyone was healed, but so many were healed. That the bar is raised. You know, you just have this expectation. Your faith grows when you start out small. Agnes Sanford used to always say, just pray for a cold when you start.
Start small.
Don't start with cancer.
Right.
You know, start small.
That is it. And of course, the Sanfords were the real pioneers, I guess, in this.
Yes.
Well, it's a very exciting topic. You've been here in New York doing a conference.
Yes.
Drives me crazy. I was not able to get to that conference, but that's all right. There will be more. You've got to come back. Folks, I'm talking to Judith MacNutt about healing in this day and age. Can you even imagine that a rational person would believe that? Well, hey, whoever said I was rational. We'll be right back. It is the Eric Metaxas Show. MetaxasTalk.com is the website. And folks, we have an app. You go on your phone, go to the App Store. On Android, we've got it. It is a beautiful app, and you can listen to all our past shows. It's just so well done. I recommend it to you. Download it today. folks. It's the Eric Metaxas Show. We're talking about healing. If you don't believe that Jesus can heal people today, you're the audience I'm looking for. I'd like you to keep listening. Keep an open mind. I think it's always important to be skeptical and open-minded at the same time. Don't buy garbage, because there are plenty of people selling looniness. Don't buy looniness. If something is not true or something doesn't smell right, you know, run. But I happen to have the joy of being in studio with Judith MacNutt, who has, in her whole adult life, lived out this world of healing prayer with her husband, Francis MacNutt. You now live in Florida, is that right?
That's right, Jacksonville.
And you've been down there for a while, actually.
Yes, we moved there right after we married in 1980.
In 1980, okay. Mm-hmm. And so what are some of the more dramatic stories that you can tell to build people's faith? Because I do find that when you hear a story sometimes that it sort of gets the juices flowing.
We've just seen so many wonderful healings. I think, to me, the greatest healings are the inner healings, really, because those are the ones.
Now, talk about that, because people don't know what that even means. We understand if I pray for a tumor or I pray for the blind to see. But when you say inner healing, tell us about that.
Well, yeah, inner healing, because I am a therapist, I'm very interested in the inner person, emotions. And I find that, you know, so many of us can live with physical problems, but a broken heart, for instance, or shattered dreams and things like that are so difficult to live with. And we tend to live in a culture that isolates so incredibly anyway. And so if we're not just really healthy emotionally and we carry all the wounds from the past and rejections and divorce and all those things, you know, we tend to isolate even more. And that's always been my heart, and I think that was the heart of Jesus. He really reached out to people that were suffering on every level. And we also see, Eric, people healed physically when they take care of their areas of brokenness.
It's interesting. I was talking to Ken Ham. I don't know if you know Ken Ham here. He has a similar ministry. And it always comes up that oftentimes when somebody, let's say, forgives someone that they had something against, a physical healing can come out of it. Now, this does not mean that every time somebody is ill, that there's an inner healing component. So we don't want to, you know, that can become a terrible lie and people can beat you over the head with it, that if you've got cancer, it's because you did this or this or this. That we're not saying that. But it is interesting that there can be a correlation. And you have seen this thousands of times, that when people deal with an issue of inner healing, there's a physical manifestation.
Oh, absolutely. And there's so many different diseases that kind of originate. Well, psychogenic illnesses, they originate in your emotions, they originate in your pain. And through either therapy or therapy and inner healing prayer, through forgiveness, that person can really be healed on every level. Now, they're not everything. Of course, some people have congenital illnesses, some people are in accidents, some people just simply have a disease.
Right.
And we see God healing those areas all the time. That's just blind eyes, cancer.
So you have seen, I just have to say this, you have seen blind eyes healed.
Absolutely. That's frequent.
Now, why do you think, because, you know, you're a doctor, okay, so why does modern medicine not look into this? I mean, the idea that somebody who's blind could come to see, it's one thing to say, oh, your skin looks better. I mean, that's harder to determine. But when somebody is blind and they can see, this is, you know, to me, that's like in the man lands on moon, you know, type size on the front of the New York Times. This is big news.
Well, we did a study on rheumatoid arthritis a few years ago, and we had at least a third of the patients that we prayed for completely healed. That was published in a medical journal. We have it documented, you know, all the studies were done on it. And no one really picked up on it.
Do you remember the name of the journal?
Not right now.
I guess this is the kind of thing that, first of all, there's a bias in medicine and often in the world of science. They get uncomfortable with these premises, you know, much less when you come up with some kind of proof. But what kinds of blindness have you seen healed? In other words, when people talk about blindness, there are all kinds of causes of blindness. It could be a severed optic nerve. It could be something else. What have you seen?
Well, we've really seen all of those. Some people with severe cataracts where their vision is just very blurred, like my mother had that and had to have surgery. You know, we've seen that healed. We've seen people with detached retinas, you know, all different, optical nerve issues. And it's just they're healed. Suddenly they'll say, I was blind, just like the men in Scripture with Jesus.
Yeah.
I was blind. Jesus right. laid hands on him.
Yeah.
He said, can you see?
Yeah.
I always loved that Jesus interviewed people.
Yeah.
He said, can you see? And the man said, I see, but I see people walking around like trees.
Yeah.
And Jesus touched him a second time.
Right. So even Jesus touched. Had to pray twice.
Yeah, that always encourages me.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you, though, because let's say I think that there are people listening to this program all across the United States and around the world, actually. People listen on podcasts in about 60 or 70 countries. I'm amazed mm-hmm. to say that. But so somebody is, you know, sitting someplace and they hear us talking about this and they say, well, I've got this, or my mom has this, or my dad has this, and my son has this. What do I do? How can I get to a place where I can get prayed for this? I mean, first of all, I'm assuming they can come to where you all are in Florida.
Yes. Yes.
How does that work? What's the name of the ministry? Let's put out a website here.
Yes, we have our ministry in Jacksonville is Christian Healing Ministries.
Christian Healing Ministries.
Yeah,
couldn't be simpler than that.
We have a website that is ChristianHealingMen.org.
ChristianHealingMen.org.
Yes, so they can look us up anywhere in the world on that and
okay.
find out the ministry opportunities.
Okay.
But we also have people all over the world, really, that have been trained through our schools of healing prayer that we have, you know, we can refer people to if they can't get to Florida.
Right.
You know, the sad thing, though, Eric, is it's not only science and medicine that doesn't appreciate it. It's many of the churches.
Oh, I know. It stuns me.
I mean, it stuns me.
No. It stuns me. There are people that, even people that I really love and admire and are friends with, that they have a theology that says, nope. And I think, where in the world? I mean, it really is. You're really stretching Scripture if you think you can prove that the Holy Spirit is not healing people today. I mean, it's like, well, then why would He be converting people today? Why would He be doing anything today if we've got the, you know, we've got the Bible and that's that? Anyway, there are a lot of churches that are closed to this, and I think it's a funny thing because just because stuff can be mushy and weird doesn't mean there's not a real version of it. Just because there's some people that are, you know, half nuts does not mean that there are people that are not nuts. And that's why I was so impressed when you and Francis came in 1989, I guess it was, maybe it was 1990, and did a healing conference at St. Paul's Darien, Connecticut. I said, this is real. There's no doubt about it. And your books are very sober-minded. And what is the major book on healing that you and Francis have out?
I think the one that I would recommend is Healing. It's just simply called Healing.
Healing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an updated version of the one that he wrote
yes.
Quite a while ago. It's
yes.
the basics.
Yes, it's still the classic.
It's the classic, yeah. Well, because people need to educate themselves about this and about what the Bible says about it. Otherwise, there are a lot of people that think, well, that's not for today. It's demonic. And, you know, look, let's be honest. If the devil says to me, hey, Eric, I can heal you and heal your parents, whatever, you don't want that healing. That's like Adolf Hitler saying, oh, are you short of a little money? I can help you out.
Yes.
Or it's a mafia guy says, are you short of money? I can lend you the money. If you borrow that money from the wrong source or you get that healing or that gift from the wrong source, you will regret it.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I think one of the really good books, if there's anyone really interested in this, is called The Healing Reawakening.
The Healing Reawakening. And is that your book? I can't remember the healing.
It's Francis's.
Francis's book, The Healing Reawakening. And Francis is E.S.?
I.S.
Francis I.S. Francis MacNutt. And MacNutt, we've got to spell it. It's M-A-C capital N-U-T-T. M-A-C capital N-U-T-T. I want to make sure that I get that right. So we have Judith MacNutt and Francis MacNutt. Francis with an I. I should have known that. And the website is ChristianHealingMen.org, and the name of the ministry is Christian Healing Ministries, and the books are Healing and the Healing Reawakening. This is just so important. I'm glad we have you for the full hour. We're going to go into another break here and get you some water for your cough. But I'm going to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, this is real, and I know anybody out there who's suffering, you want help, right? You want help, and you want to make sure that it comes from God, not from some weird source. But let me recommend the work of Judith and Francis MacNutt. And this is ChristianHealingMen.org. And again, we are the Eric Metaxas Show, MetaxasTalk.com.
Stay with me. Other dancers may be on the floor.
Really to see you again after so many years, Judith. And let me ask you, you talk about inner healing, and there are ways to pray for that, and I think you talk about that in your books, because it's important that people know how to pray. But what do you say to folks who've seen the weird stuff? They've seen, you know, ministries that they just say, that's just off, and that guy on the stage is off, mm-hmm. and I don't know what's going on there. What do you say to those folks?
Well, that really is a recent occurrence. That's really just in this century, you know, and it really is a style that was kind of birthed in like 1905.
06, Azusa Street.
Azusa Street, 06. You're right, 06. You got a good memory. Yeah, we actually did the 100th anniversary of Azusa Street out in California with, you know, like 25,000 people, you know, that came, and it was wild. But it really is a model that has been just carried since about that time.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, healing now is labeled as something that happens in tents, that happens, you know, with televangelists.
Yeah.
And as a result, it can't really be incorporated in the church or in the liturgy, you know, because of that. People think, are you like Oral Roberts?
Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong with Oral Roberts, but it's a style. So what attracted me so much to Francis the first time I saw him was this brilliant Dominican priest, graduated Harvard, St. Thomas Aquinas Institute. You know, I read his books and I thought, this man is brilliant. He's put it in a framework that I, as a person of science, could accept.
Yeah.
And he normalized it. And one of his great, you know, Francis and I have been in the healing ministry over 100 years together.
Wow.
You know, and I always say most of that's on his side, of course. But I've been doing it for 40 years. And I've seen, like, we were working here in New York City this weekend in a church, a Baptist church.
Yeah.
And the people are so excited, but the people were from all over. I mean, people came from everywhere. But what they're so excited about and what they say about this ministry is how balanced it is.
Yeah.
And it's one of integrity. And it's something that can be incorporated in the church. It could be incorporated in hospitals.
Yeah.
We do a lot of training with hospital chaplains and, you know, so it's time to bring it back to the church. It really is. It's time to bring it back to the church.
Well, I totally agree. And I'm so sorry I wasn't able to get to the conference this weekend, as I said. But we've got to have you back. Now, I'm trying to think, who brought you? Was it Matt Bennett and company this
no,
time?
No, we've worked with Matt quite a few times with Christian Union. This was something that this church invited us to come.
Which church is that?
Trinity Baptist.
Oh, that's a cult. Don't go there.
Oh, no.
I'm kidding. No, listen, Trinity Baptist has been doing God's work in the city for a long
Since
time.
The 1800s.
That's Keith Boyd.
Yes.
And honestly, it just thrills me that there are a number of churches open to this in the city. But we've got to have you back in New York, because there's been a need, particularly in New York, that there hasn't been a lot of this kind of ministry. And people are so hungry to see lives change. If you get healed, you'll never be the same. And I don't mean physically. I mean, you're going to be
just set free.
You're going to be so excited about God because you've seen this kind of thing, you know. Now, do you ever see deliverances, you know, where you have – what's the matter? You don't want me to ask about deliverances?
No, we had so many this weekend. That's
why
I'm laughing. And
people don't know what that means.
Well, and we weren't even teaching on it. We didn't even teach on the subject. Well, what we were doing here, Eric, is we have these schools of healing prayer. There's four levels, and people start out with level one, go all the way through four, and we train clergy, doctors, therapists.
What is level one? You pray for zits?
No. Well, no. Level one is kind of scriptural foundation. What is physical healing?
Okay.
We basically start with four kinds of healing.
Okay.
Physical healing, inner healing, spiritual healing, which is in the nature of forgiveness, and then deliverance from evil spirits. So those are the four we teach at Christian
Healing
Ministries.
Just lost 30% of the audience.
Of
think,
course.
Whoa, forget it.
Oh,
they're nuts.
Course.
They're nuts. We don't believe that. Jesus believed it, but he was just a simple guy. You know, we can't believe what he believed. He didn't have a college degree. Well, if that's your point of view, what can I say? Okay, so But, I mean, it is a dramatic thing when people hear us talking about evil spirits. But if you believe in angels, you know, there's a spiritual world.
Yes.
And people are afflicted. And in the third world, they have no problem believing in this stuff. They see this all the time. But you actually, in New York, you're praying for people and you see this kind of stuff.
Well, it wasn't even when we were praying. One woman at lunch started what we call manifesting at the table.
What does that mean? What does that mean?
She just started acting almost psychotic, but she wasn't, you know. And something is like being expressed. And it's like intense emotion, but it's more than emotion.
And now, is this because, I mean, I always want to be logical, right?
I know.
I think it's because the presence of God is particularly strong.
That's absolutely it.
In other words, you have a bunch of people, you and your team, you've been praying and praying and praying.
Yes.
So the presence of God is strong. So the nasty stuff doesn't like it.
Doesn't
and
like
it begins
it.
To act out.
Well, it doesn't want the person to be free.
Right.
They've had a home there for a long time.
I mean, I tell you, I just... You know. Okay, folks, we're going to listen to a little John Lennon, and we're going to be right back with Judith MacNutt. We're talking about a very important subject. Listen with an open mind, and you can be skeptical too. It's very important that we're careful and rational, but open-minded and open-hearted in very important stuff. It's the Eric Metaxas Show. We'll be right back. ChristianHealingMin.org. That's Christian Healing Ministries, but the website is ChristianHealingMin.org. So it's, for a lot of people, they don't understand how this works. And I think that, you know, you want to break it down. It's almost like when Freud talked about, you know, the soul, or there's this model. And so the model is that if you bring God into a situation, it's kind of like if you start pouring water into a pool that has been sitting empty all winter, right?
Yes.
There's all kinds of leaves and junk on the bottom that's going to get stirred up.
Yes.
It's going to come up, you know.
Yes.
And I really think that that's kind of what happens when the genuine presence of God, and most people, I would say, have not experienced this. A lot of people listening to this, they don't know. They, you know, maybe they go to church, but they've not experienced this kind of reality. But when God manifests, things can happen. Healings happen. And then there are these what you call manifestations of evil spirits that have been clinging to people that suddenly start getting uncomfortable. And then you, because you have a trained eye, recognize this.
Yes.
And then what do? You pray for these people.
We just pray for them. You know, it was so amazing. Jesus. I'm so sorry. Yeah.
You know, there are people thinking like, this woman, physician, heal thyself.
No, it's just because I've talked all weekend.
I know, I'm kidding you.
I've been lecturing all
weekend.
But
you know that there are people listening thinking like, man, she's talking about praying for like, you know, restoring the blind.
I'm not sick.
Blind,
no.
And she's, and here she is coughing. No, I've been the same way, actually. I got something, a tickle in the throat, and it's been torturing me forever,
but
that's okay.
Well, when Jesus in the scripture, and this is what I explained it to the group, because many in the group had never seen a person manifest a demonic presence. So I read the scripture, you know, from the gospel, from Matthew, that said when Jesus walked into a synagogue, a demon manifested through a person and said, "What do you want with us, Jesus, the Holy One of God? Have you come to destroy us?" What's a simple answer? Yes. Simple. So when Jesus walked into a room, into anywhere, demons start to manifest because he's God. I mean, you know, he's God incarnate. So when the Holy Spirit shows up in a meeting and the power of God comes through the Holy Spirit, people start manifesting. And another thing, we had a healing service, you know, the last day, Saturday, 2 days ago. And I said, how many of you in this room out of about 300 people, how many of you are in pain? And of course, you know, 75% of people, and of course, anyone over 30 has something wrong with their body. And I said, just stand up where you are. And we prayed, like, for people's frozen shoulders and for their bad backs and everything. And it was remarkable. I'd say, like, 10% of them were completely healed. And 70% of them had pain that diminished. So I said, okay, so that has started. So now all you have to do is keep praying until it comes all the way through. So it's like when the power of God, other people, the Holy Spirit comes and people start crying, because they remember being abandoned as a child. They remember something horrible like incest or sexual abuse, and they've never talked to anyone about these things. And the Holy Spirit just knows exactly where to go within us, you know, to find that memory and then to bring healing into that memory. So it's on all these different levels. And then forgiveness is another huge thing that happens, just huge.
I just have to laugh because I know there are people listening that they've had this traditional view that Christianity is really boring.
Oh, no.
It's just the opposite. You've seen the phony version, unfortunately, but the real version is anything but boring. I think that, you talk about that people are walking around with wounds. And it's just like what the body does, the psyche does the same thing, that if you have a trauma, right? I mean, if I get if somebody shoots me with a shotgun when I'm 12 years old and a couple of BBs are still in there, the body will create – something around it to sort of separate it. And it's the same thing. I mean, Freud, he got most things wrong, but what he did get right is that when you have a traumatic experience, your psyche creates levels around it to compartmentalize it so that you're not dealing with it.
Absolutely.
And what happens when God comes and he wants to operate, right?
Yes.
And so he puts his finger on that. He wants to take that out. And that's when people will have memories of things and things, emotions will come up. And that's exactly what's supposed to happen so that God can kind of go in, the great physician can go in and deal with this. But most people don't believe that's possible. I often think that women who've had abortions, they're walking around with this pain and all they hear in the media is, it's the best decision you ever made. And then you're not supposed to have any pain. Get over it. And they say, well, you know what? I can't get over it. And I don't want to think about it, but I think about it. And what do I do with that? And God wants to come and say, I heal. I want to heal you. I want to forgive you. I love you. And when they come into a situation like this kind of healing ministry, like you're talking about, these things can get dealt with once and for all.
Yes. One of my friends, well, two of them actually, they're both psychologists, Dr. Vince and Susan Rue. They work in the pro-life movement. One of the things they call a woman who's had an abortion that hasn't processed it or have been healed is what they call baby on the brain. And it's just like the baby was in the utero, now it's on your brain, and it's there all the time. And they know that if they hadn't had that abortion, there would be this human walking around in the world, you know, that could be a source of love for them and joy. You know, so one of the things the Lord does over and over and over, because he has so much mercy and so much love, is people that have had, women that have had abortions, men that have been a part of that, it just starts to come up in these meetings, and they find great mercy, great forgiveness, and great healing. And then what's even more beautiful, Eric, is they're able to commit that baby now to God's care and know that they'll see that child again in heaven. And it's just one of the most, God actually comes with a name. He comes with a name and gives them the sex of the child and the name, and they have a little memorial service and commit that child to God. It's an incredible experience to be a part of.
It's so beautiful. I want to say to the folks listening, there is hope for you. And God desires to heal you and to bring you through these kinds of things.
Yes.
And the one place to start, I would say, is ChristianHealingMen.org. That's Christian Healing Ministries. And the website is ChristianHealingMen.org. And the books are Healing by Francis and Judith MacNutt and The Healing Real. Get to do a lot of media, a lot of radio, or a lot of Christian radio programs wary of getting into this stuff?
I don't do a whole lot, no. I had a radio program for a while myself just to talk about healing, and then I just didn't have time to continue it. But most people just want to interview us about our books or about healings.
Right.
You know, every now and then I get a skeptical person. You know, and
but even in the Christian world of radio.
Oh, sure. Sure. Well, you know, the church, so many of the denominations teach that this is a new dispensation. Miracles only happened in the first 500 years. And then
Wait a minute. Where do they get that from? The first 500 years? The Council of Chalcedon?
I know. It's bizarre when you think about it. Well, they say healing really stopped with the last apostle.
Right.
That it was just to build the early church. But it was around the 500. Healing kind of went to holy sites, or only holy people could pray. So, you know, who thinks they're holy? You know, I certainly don't think I'm holy. I'm working on it. You know, but, I mean, do you know how many jumbo jets leave New York City in the summer to go to Lourdes? be prayed for. I mean, it's like 700 a day or something ridiculous, huge number. And why can't they go to a church here in New York City? Right. Why can't they go to a church somewhere instead of a sick person getting on a plane to go to Lourdes, France?
Right.
You know, so it's really bizarre when you we've lost our inheritance. This is what I've heard my husband say over and over. We've lost our inheritance. We've lost the inheritance of being filled with the Holy Spirit, operating in that power. We've lost the inheritance of healing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's time to bring it back to the church. It's just, it's really crazy because there's a hurting world and the church doesn't know how to help them.
Right.
They keep teaching them. They think with more and more teaching, they can bring about some righteousness or holiness or something.
Well, we've got to bring you back to New York. I've got to talk to my friend Matt Bennett to do another conference because I think it's very important, especially in a place like New York. There's just, you know, there are very few churches that are, you know, willing to get into this kind of thing. And especially you invite somebody from out there. You know, they may pray in there, but they don't know who you are or something. And but I think it is important for people to realize, hey, it's real. It's real. Just like anything else, it's real. There's good, there's bad. You know, if you find the right people, good. If you find wacky people, that's bad. So you want to be careful. So I try not to bring the wacky people onto this show. I have succeeded today. But Judith, I just want to say thank you so much for being with us. We're going to have you for one more show that we'll record and we'll air, if not next week, then the week after. But it's just it's a joy to talk about the reality of this. And I do think of the people listening who know nothing about this reality.
Yes.
And I know that you meet them sometimes, that they're not churchgoers. They just want help.
They want help. They need help.
And they know that. Yes. And they have the humility to come ask for it.
Yes.
And good things happen. So, folks, you've been listening to me talking with Judith MacNutt. Again, Judith, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And, folks, it's the Eric Metaxas Show, MetaxasTalk.com. I want to encourage you to download our app for Android or Apple iPhones. It's an amazingly designed app. You can guess that I did not design it, but it is just great. We've got every podcast. It's all there. So check it out, and thanks for listening. I don't care what they do.